everyone, and welcome to Blue Tengu's Game Development Show, where we show everything that goes into making a game for about 2 hours a week. Yes, panda bits just in time. The cheesy intro is always. For those of you on YouTube, you don't have to suffer through the cheesy intro. We just always jump right into it. But for those of you on Twitch, yes, you get to enjoy the cheesy intro every week. And Hollowfire and PandaBits are already here in the chat with me. Hollowfire came back from EGX Rezzed, which sounds like an awesome event. As a question, of the games you saw there, which one is the one that kind of got your attention the most? Like, in terms of surprise, obviously, like Dark Souls 3, things like that, you know it's coming, but if there was a game where it took you by surprise, it'd be kind of cool to hear about that. And yes, PandaBits. The show where PandaBits butts right into the intro spiel. Well, you're part of the show, so it's good that you're in the intro. Let me jump to the desktop so I can get right into it. It is 5 a.m. in Japan right now. My mind is doing better this week than last week, though. I think I'm more awake. I'm not sure why, because I've only been getting about 5 hours of sleep for the past like 3 or 4 nights, but maybe I'm getting used to that stuff. I don't know. Between last week and this week, obviously I've got the kid back, school st just started and all that, so I don't really have any me time. So in terms of overtime, didn't do much. I dimmed the background during the pause. That was something I let's see, was it? I think talking to Risa401 last week about the dimming the background stuff, I figured I might as well put it in there. So when you pause the game, the background gets dimmed a little bit. Same thing with the artifacts menu. Those were just a quick fix. Just took an hour, so not too much overtime. But this week, what I want to do is add a little bit of fuzzy logic to the enemies. What I mean is a little bit of fuzz between the state changes. And I wrote a detailed article about it over at bluetengu.com. So if you go to bluetengu.com and look for fuzzy logic versus black and white enemy AI, there's a nice long thing about what I want to do. Yes, nice and long. But basically, what I want to do is add these fuzzy logic state changes. So instead of just having triggers so that the enemy is like, just floating around, and then you're in range, so it starts to chase you. And then if you're out of a further range, it just goes back to passive. Instead of having these states be instant, I want to have a little bit of a buffer in there, so it's like the enemy starts to get a little more, a little more aware of you, and then switches over, and have a little bit of a random like fuzz factor in there as well, so that the player can't just exploit, ranges and things like that. And what I mean is, first of all, state machines. I guess if you don't know what a state machine is, it's basically just a very simple AI construct. Let's try to make the simplest one we can. By the way, I still can't figure out exactly how to readjust my mic to get rid of like these harsh S's that seem to come across the last couple of weeks. I know it's something like when the microphone in my like OBS source disappeared and I put it back in, well, the camera source, I put it back in. Ever since then, it's been kind of fishy, and I can't figure out why I had it working fine before and why it's not working now. I keep trying different things, but it's hard to tell because sometimes the S's do go, show up, and sometimes they don't. Obviously, the easy way to get rid of them is like a pop filter or something, but I didn't need it before, so I know it's a setting. And because the mic is on my camera and attached to the side, it's like a little stereo camera, Logitech 920. Pop filter's not going to quite work because I would have to have the filter between my mouth and the microphone, which would put it between my mouth and my face and the camera. So that'd be kind of weird. I can't really do the pop filter thing. I guess I could try to not speak at the mic and just like look depressed and always have my head down. I suppose that's one way to go about it. One problem with waking up early is that my sibilants are even more hissy. It's one of the things that happens. But anyway, state changes. So like for example, you could have, and we'll think of a really simple like FPS example rather than something in Project Skyring. So like for example, patrolling. Well, let's go with Metal Gear Solid. Here we go. Metal Gear Solid's an easy example. I don't know about the latest Metal Gear Solid, but old Metal Gear Solids anyway. That's going to be easy enough to do. Alert. Attacking. Okay, there's also another state actually in here. Chasing. Okay. So if the enemy has not seen Snake and is just walking around doing its thing, it's in the patrol mode. It's kind of a passive mode here. Let's just kind of do that. That's not a great color thing. Let's just put it around there. All right. So it's a pretty passive state, you know. The players, no one's on alert. The player can do whatever they want. But if the player does get partially spotted, the enemies do go into alert. And actually, these states might be the same. These might be equivalent. So actually, because they might be equivalent, let's just get rid of this. Basically, I don't think they're actually equivalent. There is a difference. So let's keep them separate. They're more or less the same in terms of like what the AI is doing. Basically, they're searching for you, but some of the lines they use are different. Like if they spotted you and they're starting to come down off of their alert, they'll say different things. But in terms of like the player danger, it's more or less the same. And you've got the attacking state, which is obviously they're shooting at you. They are taking aim at the player and firing. And you move back and forth between these. And there's probably actually no link there. Okay. So if the enemy is on patrol, they spot the player, they move. This is why it's called the state machine. They move to the state of alert. And then if they see the player a little bit longer, then they know that the player is there and they start to go into the attack state. If the player hides for a little bit, they'll go into the chase state. And if the player successfully continues to hide, they'll return to the patrol state. Some games, Splinter Cell does do it. There's kind of the AI state's the same, but you know they do some things behind the scenes to kind of change the lines that the enemies are saying. But Panda Bits, Tengu trying to hide my or I'm trying to hide my origins as a snake person. It's all those S's, and I've noticed like. Especially last week. Oh man, something about waking up early makes sibilants. Sibilants are like the S's, you know, the hissy sounds. Something about that makes those worse. I don't know what it is. Maybe just like mouth liquid levels or something like that. I don't know. But this is a basic state machine. You could imagine. Let's try to get two paintbrushes running at the same time. Hopefully my system can handle the intense resources required to do two paintbrushes at the same time. Seems to be doing all right. You can imagine if you do have Snake here, think of this as a top-down view. You have Snake here, you have an enemy here. You could probably have there's a lot of things that go into the calculation. There's like light levels, ray casts and obstructions and whether things are in the way and all that, but let's just keep it simple. Let's just say if Snake is in like a certain range, the enemy could spot him. So let's say he's got a range like this, and what happens is the enemy goes on alert, and then the next state, you know, a couple of seconds later, they start chasing. This is the question mark. This is the exclamation point, the bikkuri mark. And, you know, if you didn't use like a fuzzy logic, what would happen is if you're in this range, 3 seconds alert, 3 seconds later attack. You know, it's going to happen the same way every time. And, you know, you could have a bigger range. Like once the enemy's on alert, you could have a bigger range. It's really hard to do this. I should have drawn this a little better. This over here. Okay. And you could have this extra wide barrier so that you don't want to have just the same thing be the go on alert radius and the and the give up the chase radius, because then you could really start turning the enemy on and off by just kind of stepping back and forth, and that's really weird. So even just with a state machine, you usually have two radiuses. This is like if you come into the smaller one, you start the alert thing. If you put the enemy on alert, you have to leave the bigger radius to take them off alert. And that works fine, but the problem is, even with this system where you have two different radiuses, which is exactly what we're doing in Skyrim right now, the player can still kind of sense these radiuses, especially if it's the exact same distance every time. If you do randomize it, you can kind of fuzz it up a little bit as a cheat. But the player is going to keep jumping back and forth exactly the distance they need to kind of get around and stuff and put the enemy off alert and all that stuff, which is fine. Like if it's a puzzle game, that's perfectly fine. Like you could imagine if the like probably like the original Metal Gear games, not Solid, the original Metal Gear games, like the top-down ones on the Nintendo and stuff. It's more puzzly, so it makes more sense to kind of not make this so fuzzy, because you want the player to know exactly how far they can kind of push things. In that case, it's fine to do, just make things very clear, like this is how far you're going to be before you get spotted. But if you want the game to feel more real, the problem is if you do that, enemy AI starts to feel a little artificial. And, the player feels too comfortable, so there's no suspense or drama. They know exactly what it's going to take. Like, for example, if you're in Silent Hill, especially like a horror game, you would not want to do this. If the monsters always reacted at a certain distance and then gave up at a certain distance, they feel artificial. They don't feel like monsters. So what you want to do is fuzz things up. And the way you can do that is, we're gonna go for three paintbrushes. Let's see if my computer can handle it without crashing. You have kind of a graph going. Keep wanting to use Photoshop controls. You would have like an alert state, like down here. Well, let's see, this is the patrol states. Let's just make this green. Let's keep it the same. And let's put the alert state up here. The way it's working now with the state machine, it would be something like this. Come on. It basically looks something like that. The enemy's on patrol until they reach a certain point, and then suddenly, boom, they're in the alert state. What fuzzy logic does is obviously it's not zeros and ones, it's more gray, so it's a little more fuzzy. So you have this kind of gray zone here where things are kind of building up into this state. So you're technically, like if you were using the old system, the enemy would have switched over right away, but because you're just kind of fuzzing this up, the enemy doesn't go into alert right away. And you do the same thing kind of coming back as well. And if you make this just an incrementing value, it's not too different from using like timers and things like that. But if you did use like a bit of randomness, this is gonna look weird, but here we go. If you do use a bit of randomness, probably the better way to represent it is sometimes the lines are like this, sometimes the lines are like this. Basically, you have a range. If you do have a bit of a fuzzy range, like a bit of a random range, what you can do is the enemies are much more difficult to predict. They feel more like human beings. Like you could imagine if there are, three people looking for Arnold Schwarzenegger. One of them's going to be, a young go-getter who's looking for a promotion within the evil terrorist organization. He's on alert. He's pretty quick to spot Arnie, even if he's hiding in the shadows. Whereas if you have like the lazy old hand, the guy that's been like a merc forever and he's just taken home a paycheck, It may take him a while looking at Arnie in the darkness and go, is someone there? And then suddenly go on attack. So you can kind of have a bit of a personality thing going as well. Yeah, scent pandabits, then you can cheese it. But this is basically making things fuzzy, which is why it's fuzzy logic. There are definitely better places that'll go into much, much more depth on what it actually is. Wow. Okay. That's probably because it's me. But fuzzy logic, that's the Japanese version, which is not good. There we go. There's a good example. Temperature, like human beings with temperature. Whether a person thinks it's cold, warm, hot, you know, these different things. There's these kind of cutoffs. Like sometimes it depends on what you're wearing, you know, whether you've warmed up the couch or not, before sitting on it. Things like that can all determine like whether as a human being you're in the warm state or the hot state or the cold state. It's the same thing. Actually, this Wikipedia article is pretty empty, so there might be better places. But if you do have access to the old book, Game Development Gems, it has a section in there on it. That's one place to go. But let's close this down. And so we want to do fuzzy state switching logic in Project Skyring. So let's show you. Let me save all these in case they come in handy. Not that these are great pictures, but fuzzy logic. Fuzzy logic 1, 3. Yeah, I'll keep it up. May come in handy. Fuzzy logic 2 and fuzzy logic 3. But let's get Game Maker up and get it started. Suburban merc dad. Yeah, just the guy that's bringing home a paycheck, putting food on the table, and Arnie snaps his neck and deprives his family of their father. Let's see. But, you know, going back to that website, actually, I probably should have kept it up because it does have a list of the states I need to change. Probably won't get all of the states done today, but I could probably get quite a few of them. Once I figure out the system, it shouldn't be too much extra work to kind of put it into other places. But these are the ones we need. And it's probably best to break these out into tasks. But let's see. Yeah, let's go ahead and do that now while we're waiting for Game Maker anyway. So enemy chase to passive. So chase the passive, 0.5 enemy. Fuzzy logic, obviously passive to chase. Those are the two obvious ones. Before I forget to do that, let's close that. Anchor chase to player chase. So whether they're trying to go after your tail or whether they're trying to go after you directly, that's another kind of state change. Player chase. They tend to pick whichever one's closer. Swarm, which is if the player gets in the middle of them, they just kind of collapse on the player. That one may not need fuzzy logic. That one, we'll see. Swarm. So chase the swarm. And the other way. Because that one's more of kind of a direct reaction. That's more like, you know, their attack. So it'd be like putting fuzzy logic on when the enemies shoot at you. Yeah, that's may not be worth doing in terms of fuzzy logic. Just making it simple might be better for the players too. But we'll think about it. Enemy ground to air. So whether the enemies on the ground pursue you into the air, or whether they go from the air onto the ground to pursue you. Those are also kind of states. Ground to air. Surface to air. I should say surface to air. It sounds so much cooler. Like a missile. Can I change it here? There we go. That's better. These are all game design things. A surface to air. Okay. And air to surface. Also, kind of realized this the other day, but PandaBits, did you know that Unreal, the engine, has what they're going to be doing on Trello? That was kind of cool to see that, because I'd always been following them in other places, but since you're here, let's see. Epic Unreal Engine Trello. I'd probably pull it up. There you go. The Unreal Engine for roadmap. During like classes and stuff when searching for business roadmaps, I actually came across this, but here we go. They're using Trello too. So go Trello. But basically they've got like, the tasks and kind of what they're working on Trello as well. So it could be kind of interesting to see this. Plus you got votes and all this other stuff. And I think in terms of like the number of votes, they probably don't look at it and start shifting things around based on how popular things are, I don't think. Because probably the subset of, engine users who are actually actively following the Trello roadmap is not representative of the big sample. But who knows? Maybe they are using samples and stuff and moving things with higher votes up the list in terms of priority. But this is very interesting. So yeah, it's, not so much for like scheduling and stuff like that, but 4.12, all the stuff that's going to be going into the next update. It's kind of interesting just to see like their work state, because obviously they're dividing this by like probably the teams that are working on this stuff. There's probably a blueprint team, an AI team, an animation team, and it looks like they're more or less going agile with this. So either agile or lean, either one can use this sort of structure, and they're probably just like putting them in priority order and stuff. So that's kind of interesting. Very different from very different from ours. They don't put pretty pictures in it, so we win. So let's turn this one off because we've broken it down into individual tasks. And let's start on it. The first one's going to be the one that takes the longest, just because we're figuring things out. So even though I've got them all at like half an hour, the first one's going to take long. The next ones aren't going to take so long. But chase the passive. And let's see. There's probably a more subtle states as well. Player chase the passive. Passive to player chase. Because there's also switching to anchor chase and things like that. So that actually, just so we don't forget it. 0.25 enemy, fuzzy logic. Passive to anchor chase. Passive to player chase. One thing that's going to make fuzzy logic a little bit difficult to do is the fact that we're using Game Maker. And you could have AI managers and stuff and kind of split out the AI managers and object and have things working there. But normally, like if you were working in Unity or Unreal, you'd probably have different threads and things like that. So you'd be able to do these things kind of at the same time and slowly build up a parameter kind of in the background and then switch states and all that stuff. The problem with Game Maker is it's a very linear scripting system. So it's going to be kind of tough to put this stuff into what we've got now. We'll see. We'll see. But let me show you where we're at with Skyring before I do that. What the AI is like now. It's might take some time to compile. Yeah, it's gonna do its usual like compiling all the sounds thing. That's the problem with having all the music and the voice in the game right now, is it wants to convert it every time. I wish there was a way like to set it to not do that, like to remember like your temp settings or something. Unfortunately, it does use temp folders every time you open it up. So the first time opening it up, it always takes a while to get started. That's one thing where it feels like they could make it more efficient. It's like Unreal, for example. Like if you don't have to rebuild the lighting every time you jump in the engine. Obviously, if you've rebuilt the lighting the last time you were in there, that's kind of what it's doing with the audio, because it's putting it all in a temp folder when it's converting it. Me just see something real quick. I have my mic on, or my sound on, as far as I can tell. I'm not sure why it's not coming across. Is it just my audio volume? Might just be because my speaker is too low. I see. I did put the music volume down. Okay. I'll just keep it subtle. Because, yeah, when I was editing the stream last week, I realized, like, when I was talking with this menu open and stuff, the music was kind of getting in the way, so I took that off. But let's go ahead and continue. So we've got the player. Let's see if we can get an enemy to show up in the middle of a blizzard right now. Okay, so let's see if we can get on the same level as this enemy. So there you go. Right now it's in the chase, the anchor state, chase the player state. So there's the swarm thing where it's trying to come in and attack the player. And if you get far enough away, it gives up. So it's more or less, on and off behavior. Apologies for the blizzard making things dark. It looks fine on the monitor, but probably on the stream, it looks a little dark there. But what we're doing is we're controlling that through the enemy core. The enemy core is the thing that has like the all of those enemy nodes and is controlling the movement and AI and stuff. And during the step, there's a super enemy and a regular enemy, and they behave a little bit differently. But basically, it says check for a close player. So if the distance to the player is less than EM spread times the EM spread factor, just two constants, times like the enemy list size, so that bigger enemies have a wider range and things like that, because the core is in the middle of those enemies. It'll start swarming the player. If they're within pursuit range, they'll start pursuing the player. And if they're close enough to an anchor, they'll pursue that. So if you have a really long tail, rather than pursue you, they'll get on your tail and then start kind of boosting around after you. But these are all kind of on-off figures, basically. So you can kind of switch the enemy on and off. So what we have to do is say, if you're in a certain range, increment a factor, and if that factor gets over a certain number, then switch over. And if the player is out of that range, then decrement the factor. Don't just reset it to zero, but start like knocking it down. So if the player does move out of range for a second but gets back in, the player's not starting from, or the enemy's not starting from scratch on their state change. So actually, I do want to back this up because this may be the last time for a while that the enemies work properly. It's probably worth doing an old school backup here. Game plan. Project Spaghetti. Project Skyring. Yeah, all those music files. So this is before episode 38. All right. Before I break things, let's at least remember, have fond memories of when things work. So, check for a close player. So we're going to need, let's see, we're going to need extra variables in here. Probably one for each state. Probably. So we need one for pursue player, pursue anchor, swarm. And that's probably enough. Because we could probably use the reverse of that to come out of that state. In other words, like if you could imagine if you had an arbitrary number that goes up to like 10, and when it hits 10, they start chasing you, and it stays at 10 until you get out of range, and then it starts to go down like 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. When it gets to 0, you could probably turn off that state. And Panda-bits, the super enemy Moonlights is a reporter at the Daily Mail. The super enemy. Yes. Probably reacts to the sun. Nuclear energy like Superman 4 or something. Okay, so what we need to do is add an extra kind of if in here. But before we do that, we do need the variables. So let's come out here and add them. So EM core fuzz, we'll call it fuzz. And let's see, player chase. Chase player 0. Yeah, the tricky one's going to be switching between chasing the player and the anchors. That'll be a little tricky. If it was just chase, it wouldn't be too bad. But figuring out how to handle this is going to be tricky because they could be in range of both, which means like which one do you increment it, decrement it, or keep it the same? Core fuzz. What else do we need? Swarm. And later on, we're going to need EM core fuzz ground. Okay. So that's the one we have to remember for now. And I'm not going to do it for this super enemy because if it works for this one, I can bring everything over. So if the player is close enough, let's add to this. In fact, let's see, can I do something like this? Plus equals 2. I don't want to handle this. Because we have to decrement it if they're not close enough to the player. The easy way to do it's probably, just come out here and say, even on the very outside, just say mCore fuzz chase anchor minus minus, something like that. So every step it goes down, unless you're in range, and then it goes up by 2 to kind of make up for the fact that it was going down. So it ends up being plus 1. That's the easy way to do it. Because then you don't have to put, minus, minus, minus inside of each of these little individual like cases and stuff. We'll try to do that. Too bad you can't inherit this with classes. You can inherit. Like you could have an object enemy core and then just have an object enemy core fuzz or something like that that inherits from this parent and overrides this stuff. But in the end, we're not going to have two types of enemies, so it's okay to just put it in this one. And 123 gas. Hey, good to see you. I heard, yes. Did you go to EGX Resd? Hollowfire was in here earlier, just for a little bit. But from the updates that I was seeing, it sounded like a lot of fun. Did ask a question, but I don't think he was able to hear the question and give me an answer. But when you were at the event, were there any games that kind of took you by surprise? That'd be interesting to hear about. And woke up this morning and was worried I missed the stream yesterday, but it's today. This week it worked out for you. Last week it was the other way around, where you came to the stream on the usual the old time, and then had to come twice. But at least this week it worked out for you. Yes, but thank you for dropping by. So what we're doing right now is we're adding fuzzy logic to the enemies. I do, if you want to catch up, if you go to bluetengu.com, the most recent entry is about like kind of what we're doing. So if you need to catch up and kind of figure out what we're doing, that's a good way to do it. Let's see. All swarm players equal to false. Yeah, that's fine. So this is the swarm one. Whoops. This is swarm. I guess I do want fine control over stuff, so I'm not going to do it that way. I'm going to do it this way. Plus plus. And actually, not just plus plus, because it's not fuzzy that way. What we do need to do is random range. Well, let's see. Can I do random one? I think this will work. Just need to double check. Game maker. It should return something between 0 and 1. Yeah, okay. Yeah, so it'll go between 0 and one. But I probably wouldn't want to have just zero be an option. So I guess I do need random range. So even though it's real, let's go with 0.1.5 to 1.5. So every step, it'll add anywhere between 0.5 and 1.5 to this kind of meter that's building up in the background. If they're in range. And APM core fuzz swarm. It's probably not worth breaking these out into constants because we're never going to use them anywhere else. But if APM core fuzz swarm is greater than, let's just say, because right now, theoretically, it's this. Because up until now, we've just been instantly switching them to the swarm state. But let's make it. How many frames? On average, the average is going to be about plus one every frame that's getting added to this meter that builds up. So let's see. It should be fairly quick. So it shouldn't be like minutes or anything, seconds. It probably shouldn't even be seconds so much. But let's go with 2 seconds. So room speed times two. I need to cap this as well. So when I, if they've been swarming the player forever, then this number is going to get huge, which means if I later try to decrement it, it's going to take forever for it to go down. So I do need to cap this. So I can't use plus equals. Equals clamp. Core fuzz swarm plus that. And zero. Don't really need to use clamp, but all right, we'll just use clamp. One, two, three. So room speed times two. In fact, we could actually get away with a little more fuzz here by making it a little higher. So what this will do is the meter only needs to get this high for them to start swarming the player, but it continues to go a little higher. So when if we start decrementing it. It starts from a higher state. So if the player just triggered the swarm and gets out of the way quickly, it'll go back to zero faster. Just for a little more of a fuzz factor there. Could be kind of interesting. And 123 Gas said it's difficult to say. There's a lot of awesome games that are not enough time to check them all out. Well, you were just there for one day too, right? So one day is probably not a lot. How big is the event? Like, it's hard to it's probably hard to like describe, but in terms of like floor space or number of games or number of people, whatever numbers you have, it'd be kind of interesting to hear that. I'd love to go to an event like that. Sounds like fun. Especially with a lot of indie developers there. Okay, so if they're in close range, then we do that. This one is at least easy enough because they're either swarming or not swarming, so it's easy enough to decrement stuff here. So mcore fuzz swarm equals clamp mcore fuzz swarm. I mean, and this time we're going to go the other way, minus. And I want them to come out of that state faster, so I'm going to go between 1 and 2. Minimum 0. Or minimum 0? Should we also go the other way? Like, if you've been out of the range for a while, it takes them a lot longer to kind of heat up to you and start swarming you. That'd be kind of interesting. So let's do that. So about a second worth of kind of a buffer if you've been out of their range for a long time. And so we need to do that up there as well. Make sure these clamp values are the same. Otherwise weird things will happen. So this should affect the swarm. It should take an average of about 2 seconds if it's the first time, 3 seconds. So yeah, more often 3 seconds, I guess, for them to start swarming you. And this might be enough to test it. Let's see if it's working. Probably need to add some debug stuff in there so we can actually see these like states and how the enemy is actually reacting. Because the problem with fuzzy logic is now that things are fuzzy, it's kind of going to be harder to know what state they're in. Yeah, that sound effect is when they start swarming you, so it's kind of hard to tell at the moment. Yeah, there seems to be a bit of a delay there. But we do need to put some debug information out there, don't we? How should we do this? Let's put it in the draw GUI stuff for the debug, because otherwise, if I use show debug message or something, all of the enemies that are out there are going to be showing these numbers, and it's going to be kind of hard to see. So we do have a number. That's the super enemy. Okay. So we do have this number. We want to draw it. So if global debug is true, draw altitude, draw state, fuzz factors, fuzz numbers. And that. Once we get a lot of these numbers, this will look a little weird. But now if I turn debug on, it should give me that number next to the middle of those enemies. Andres of 401! You're okay! You're okay, we're just getting started. Well, we got started 45 minutes ago, but that was mostly describing fuzzy logic and stuff. As I was mentioning to 123 gas as well. More or less, like, what I'm trying to do is over at bluetengu.com, just the fuzzy logic versus black and white enemy AI. More or less what I'm trying to do and why I'm doing it is in here, so if you miss the opening description, all you have to do is look at this and you'll be up to speed, more or less. No worries. Hope you're doing good. Hope you're having a good weekend so far. One thing that's interesting about having classes every day and every night and not getting much sleep and taking care of a kid is you forget what day of the week it is. I still don't know what it is. Like, it's like, wait a minute, Sunday? Here in Japan, anyway. Feels like it's not even Saturday yet because I haven't actually had time off. School's fun, but yeah, you lose track of time when you have no time to yourself. Okay, let's turn debugging on. hard to see with all the other stuff. I'm gonna have to take some of those things off. Let's do that. We don't care about altitude at the moment, so we're gonna take that off. We're also gonna take this stuff off. Otherwise, it's gonna be too hard to see. Okay. Yeah, go for it. Go for it, Reese. Your body's giving you a message. And 1-3 Gas mentioned the event is, it's big, but it's not huge. It's mostly difficult to catch games that don't have people playing already. But being able to see other people playing gives you an idea of what it's about and how it might feel. That's interesting. Yeah, it's mostly difficult to catch games that don't have people playing already. Yeah, because if there are a lot of people at the event, it happens with Tokyo Game Show. It's a very crowded event with not that many games, especially with more and more publishers not actually bothering to come to Tokyo Game Show. Basically, what happens is you have like Capcom with the latest Monster Hunter and, a 4-hour wait. If you want to try out Monster Hunter, there's your day, sitting in line for it. Yeah, for the most part, that's why I don't go to Tokyo Game Show anymore. Even if I am able to go on like industry days and stuff, but even then, it's still too crowded. Okay, so let's get our number. There it is. There it is. So we've got our F swarm number. It's probably a little hard for you guys to see it, but it's at -60 right now, which is -1 second worth. And if I get close, that number's starting to change. Yeah, that one's just at zero. It does feel like it's too long. So what I should do is probably expand out the swarm range itself. If I'm gonna be doing this stuff. Interesting. Yeah, and again, like I said when I was putting this list together, doing it for swarming might not be such a good idea because swarming is more of kind of an instant reaction, like an enemy shooting snake when they see snake. We'll think about it. We'll think about it. We'll keep it in there for now, but it's easy enough to pull this one out. So let's move to the next one, which is the actual pursuit one. This one will make a bigger difference. So if they are in player pursuit range, this number goes up. Chase player. Fuzz chase player. I think that's what I called it. Let me just double check. Yes, fuzz chase player. Got it. So if they're in range, that goes up. We'll keep the same kind of numbers going. If they're pursuing an anchor, see this is where it'd be kind of this is where it's going to be interesting to have you're able to subtract it within these different steps because you can subtract it in different ways. Like if they're chasing the anchor instead of the player, maybe this number doesn't go down as fast as if they're just completely out of range of everything. So yeah, let's do that. So it only goes down a little bit if they're chasing an anchor instead of the player. That should be okay. Don't chase anything is the other option. In that case, if they're out of range of everything, then we can make this number go down fairly quick. Okay. And if the player's not in the air, Then I think we can set this to zero. It'd be pretty safe to set this to zero because by the time, for example, the player went to the ground and then got up in the air again, this number would be zero anyway, so we'll just set it to zero. If the player goes to the ground, this gets set to zero. But there we go. We've got chase player at minus 60 because they're out of range. But as we get in range, chase P gets to 180, so now they're chasing the player. It's kind of hard to tell what the effect is doing because they're still able to chase the anchor right away. So it still looks like they're chasing the player, but at least logically it seems to be working. So let's actually just do the chase anchor one real quick because that'll help us like really see what's going on here. And it's getting set to zero. I see why it's getting set to zero. It's not just if the player's on the ground, it's if they're on a different altitude level. That thing down here also kicks in, so we should set this to minus room speed rather than zero. So it's the same as the bottom of the clamp. Make sure all of those numbers are the same. And okay. All right, so if they're in pursuit anchor, if pursuit anchor is true, then we want to increment the chase anchor. We want to move that up. If they are pursuing the player, we want to move it down, but just by a little bit, so that they can switch between chasing the player and chasing the anchors fairly quickly. Go back and forth fairly quickly. And let's see, anything else? And then down here, if they're not doing any of those, then we can go ahead and take away quite a bit. Okay. Anchor. We need to do this as well for anchor. Okay. And let's draw both of those values. This is going to be kind of a messy string, but I don't think I want to do the same line. Let's try this. Let's put the anchor number on top and the player number on the bottom. And spell it out. Debug object. All right. Now they shouldn't be chasing so quickly, either the anchor or the player. So it'll, even though you're in range, it should take them a second or two to kind of heat up and come after you. Numbers are a little close together. Oh, now we got a huge enemy. Need to kind of line the numbers up here. Yeah, so right now the player's kind of moving in and out of range. That's a big enemy, so it's kind of hard to tell. Still seems to be kind of instant. Still seems to be kind of instant. I think I'm not putting in the ifs. That's probably what's going on. So I've got the numbers working properly. It's just I'm not doing anything with those numbers, is the problem, like I was doing with swarm. So I need to do something like this. If Amcor Fuzz Chase player is greater than this, then do all of this stuff. And I'll catch up on the Dark Souls talk before the break. Probably with decent scrimp, I can talk about Dark Souls for a long time, because it is a game that left a big impression on me. Strong emotions involved in that game. Rage, love, disappointment, all of those emotions. Okay. We go, and we also need, if we're turning this stuff off, we also need to do ifs in here as well. Less than or equal to zero. Then we'll turn Pursue Player off. If EMCore Fuzz Chase Anchor is less than or equal to zero. Why is Pursue Anchor true? Seems like these are switched somehow. Don't chase anything, but Pursue Anchor is being set to true. That's weird. Just to leave a note to myself, why was this true? That would have been an interesting bug, I guess. Should change the enemy behavior quite a bit. Okay, and changing pursue enemy to false is fine. So only if that number drops low enough will they give up the pursuit. Let's see if this changes their behavior and then go on break. And Panabit says, what does room speed times two mean as a number? Room speed is a special number inside of GameMaker that gives you your frame rate. So like for example, 60 is the number that I'm getting back. So 60 times 2, 120 is the number I'm getting if I do times 2. But what that number does is it allows you to change the frame rate. So if for some reason, I wasn't getting enough performance out of this game and I thought, all right, I'm just going to drop it down to 30 frames per second instead of 60. It doesn't need 60, for example. Then I don't have to go in and change all of those individual numbers because room speed's going to change it all for me. If I use room speed, it means 1 second. Theoretically, it's not exact. If your frame rate drops, then it's not going to be 1 second. But if your frame rate is fine, then it'll be 1 second. And that's like the thing Risa was mentioning last week with delta time. If you do want precise like seconds, you would use delta. So let's see. Get my debug display on. Right now, both are at minus 60. There we go. It's probably hard for you guys to see this. I should probably make those numbers bigger somehow. But you can see right now the enemy is pretty quick to chase the player, and that's because those numbers aren't going down yet. But they go down over time. And every time they start pursuing the player, they go up again. So you have to kind of stay out of range for a while before they go down. But let's do that. Okay, now they're both kind of back at minus 1 second. So I'm in range, I'm in range, I'm in range. Now they start chasing me. So yes, it takes about 3 seconds for them to start chasing. Good. It was kind of hard to tell from that for you guys what was going on, guys and gals, I should say. It's just a habit. Guys, I always say guys. But here's what's going on. I'll try to draw it out so it's clearer to you than what's on that game screen. Here's my player. Here are the enemies. Here are the little links between them. And there's a core in the middle. changing the second color for some reason. And there's like an invisible core in the middle that controls them. What this is doing is, you know what, let's move the player a little closer. Move all that over there. Okay, so what's going on is there's a range. It's just numbers. It's not an actual like circle or anything that I'm using. It's not like a collision or anything like that. But there is a range around this blue circle. Centered on the blue circle, there's a range. If the player is inside of this range, then EM core fuzz chase player goes up by a random amount, somewhere between like 0.5 and 1.5. Let's say it averages out to about one per frame. If the player's in here long enough, then what? Okay. Chase player is greater than 2 seconds. So if this number, which starts at minus 1 second worth of frames, so minus 60, it starts at minus 60. If this number starts at minus 60, if the player is in here long enough, it'll eventually get up to 120. When it gets to 120, they start to chase the player. That's what's going on, and it's successful. It is working. If the player leaves here, then this number starts to go down. M core fuzz chase player minus equals by an average of about like 0.5, I think, or so. And if this number dips below zero, then they give up the chase. So if the player keeps hopping back and forth, back and forth, back and forth in here, this number never really has a chance to cool down. So they don't just switch instantly to the, I don't see the player again, move on. They don't instantly switch to that state anymore, because they've just, been kind of riled up. They're going after the player. Even if the player's a bit out of range, they're like, I'm going to keep trying to pursue them a little bit longer. But if the player stays out of range long enough, they'll eventually give up. And when they give up at the zero point, but it continues to go down until it gets back to minus 60. So even if they give up, if you jump back into the range, they're going to heat up again real quick. But if you stay out of range long enough, then they'll go back to like their original, like completely cool state where it takes a while to get them to start chasing you again. The actual numbers we're going to have to adjust because they don't chase you quite fast enough to my taste, but it's easy enough to see that it's working. So there's our fuzzy logic. At least for 3 seconds, it's easy to test because when you first encounter an enemy, it is taking about 3 seconds before they start chasing you. And after that, even if you move out of range, they're pretty quick to chase you again. So that part's good. I think the minusing part is good. It's just that initial kind of hurdle of when they start to chase you is a little too high. They don't feel that threatening anymore. And the panda bits, it maketh much sense, sir. Good. I'm glad it maketh sense. Yeah, this picture could come in handy as well. All of my paintbrush art. Future civilizations will look back at this and think there was like some meaning to these pictures. But that is the fuzzy logic that we're putting in the game. So I am going to take a break. We got the fuzzy logic actually working. It was surprisingly not too bad to implement. I do re need to remember to add it into the super enemy as well. Mostly copying stuff over once we get it kind of adjusted here. But now we need to do the surface to air and air to surface. And what that is when, if I can create the situation, if an enemy is chasing you and you go to the ground, they will tend to follow you to the ground. And the same if you're taking off. But usually only if you're within a certain range. Yeah, I'm still in the snow level, so it's gonna get dark on me, but I don't need those debug numbers anymore, so I should be okay. Let's see. Find our way to an island. Pandabits, your Heligator's still in there. I need to add a. I think I do have the task in my list to figure out what to do with this thing. Probably make it a hidden character of some sort. An island coming up. Fortunately, we don't have any enemies chasing us. Let's get on the ground, and if there's a forest in there. If this island has no forest, that's going to be disappointing. Ah, it doesn't, does it? No. So there's not going to be any ground enemies, unfortunately. To find enemies in the air to chase me down to the ground. Okay, there we go. So, if I try to go to the ground to escape the air enemies, they will follow me to the ground, so I have to kill them here. Like that. Now it's just whether to put fuzzy logic into that or not. Let's take a look at how this is working. If distance to object is less than 10, pursuit ground is true. Where am I setting that? In pursuit ground. Okay. Yeah, okay. So if the player has gone to the ground and they create a landing point object, which is where those enemies land at, and if they were pursuing the player or the player's tail or swarming the player, then they will follow the player to the ground. In that case, it might not need fuzzy logic for at least the air to ground or surface to ground case. Because there's already fuzzy logic involved in whether or not they're pursuing the player, pursuing the anchor, or swarming. So you would imagine that if the players fulfilled those conditions for the enemy to chase them to the ground, it would be more natural for the enemy to kind of follow through and chase them to the ground. So in that case, that one, air to surface, I'm going to get rid of that one. Yes. I hate warning messages. They do their job. They make me pay attention. Now let's check the other state. If we're on the ground, and whether or not we chase after the player into the air. Pick random points, step towards target, return home. On a sprite. Attack the player if they're close. Yeah, there's definitely fuzzy logic we have to add to the ground enemy. So we can certainly start doing that. Relax radius, speed. One's okay. Charging's okay. Charging's like the ground equivalent of swarming. That's if the player's not there, they'll just kind of randomly wander around. And there's the ground equivalent. So for the ground equivalent, it's if the player is close enough, they'll do it. But in this case as well, they'll only take off after the player if they're already chasing the player. So if we fuzz up the logic for whether or not the enemy is chasing the player or not, that should be enough. So we'll get rid of that one too. These ones are kind of covered by the other fuzzy logic that we've got going on. But what we do need to do is ground enemy. Passive to chase. And ground enemy. Chase the passive, obviously, the other side of that. Ground enemy chase to charge. Ground enemy. There might not actually be a chase the charge state, because I think the charge was if the player throws the boomerang, it's that kind of sound and action of throwing the boomerang that brings all of these like enemies swarming at them. So it might actually be passive to charge. Charge to passive. So let's actually change that. Don't think the enemy switches back and forth between chase and charge. Charge to passive. Okay, those are our four states. We may have a charge to chase as well in there. If we do, we can add that real quick. In fact, those are kind of added naturally. In the same way, like chasing, whether the enemy is chasing the anchor or whether they're chasing the player. We didn't actually have to do anything explicitly for that because we were kind of handling it with fuzzy logic anyway. Okay, and super enemy logic. We probably won't get to that this week, but we'll see. So ground passive to chase. This is if they're already chasing, so that's not going to be too helpful. Attack the player if close. So if they are not charging or chasing, then we check this stuff. Interesting. They're charging. There might be some logic that needs fixing in here as well. Okay, so if the player throws a boomerang and the enemy's close enough, they're in a certain reaction radius, then they'll start charging. So that's one spot. Let's create those variables. Fuzz things up a bit. So em fuzz chase. Em fuzz charge. I think I should change the name to attacking. Yeah, because chase has a different meaning for the thing on the ground. Chase means whether they chase the player into the air. So what we need to do is change this one to attack. Okay, em fuzz attack. All right, here we go. So if there's a boomerang and the distance to the point is less than this, then we set charging to true, but we want to fuzz it up. So em fuzz charge. Is it charge or charging? Em fuzz charge, yeah. Em fuzz charge equals em clamp em fuzz charge plus random range, and I probably more or less want this one to be kind of like the swarm. And let's see. Speed times. Yeah, just to make sure they swarm faster. Half a second is enough for them to start swarming. Actually, let's make it keep it half a second. So half a second. So if the boomerang's out there for half a second, on average, start charging. Oops, that's not what I wanted to copy and paste. Movement. It's this. So 0.5 to 1.5. So an average of one per frame. 0.5 to 1.5. Minimum again. Let's go with minus room speed. Maximum room speed times. Let's just make this room speed and fix the enemy core one as well. This number doesn't have to go up so much. Okay. Is it because the whether the enemy attacks or not should be pretty instant. If your boomerang is out there for about half a second, then start charging. And EM fuzz charge. If the boomerang's not close enough, then we want this number to go down. Fuzz charge minus random range. And this range is a little smaller. And obviously, we need another else up here. If there's no boomerang, make it go down as well. Okay. So that sets charging to true. Is there anything that sets charging to false? I think once they go after you with the boomerang, they're pretty much going to keep charging you. Probably have to have some sort of distance to make sure that doesn't happen. Okay, so that's fuzz charge. And fuzz attack, we need to do that one. Why am I on that one? Player chase check. If charging or chasing is not true, so if they're not charging, then there's a chance they could start chasing you. So we've got our EM attack radius, relax radius. If EM attacking is false and they're close enough, then there's a chance to start attacking. So this is where we want to do our fuzz factor thing again. So EM fuzz attack equals clamp EM fuzz attack plus random range. And let's see what we're doing with the error enemy. Point 0.5 to 1.5 again. That's fine. 1.5. Minimum. Again, minimum is room speed. Maximum is room speed times 3. If EM fuzz attack is greater than room speed times 2, so if it's got about 2 seconds worth of charge built up, then start attacking. In fact, let's just make this 1 second, because I wanted to change that before the break as well. I wanted to change this down a little bit. Just so the enemy's a little more responsive. Okay. So same thing in here. Yeah, not plus 3 times 2. So about 2 seconds. It can hold about 2 seconds of charge. But if it's more than a second's worth, then they'll start attacking the player. If they're not close enough, then we want to subtract. So minus 0.25 and 0.5. So it goes down a little slower than it goes up. as we did before. Here we have two radiuses, the relax radius and the attack radius. So in this case, if they're already attacking the player, then unless the player gets far enough away, they don't start to relax. In fact, this doesn't need to go here, because this is, it's only going to come inside of this if statement probably about once, I think. Let's see. If I'm attacking is false. No, it will come in here. Let's just make an else that'll make it clear what's going on though. Okay, so they're not attacking, but they're not close to the player either, is going to be that. They are attacking, but the player is far enough away, then we keep subtracting. And here's where we do the zero check. If fuzz attack is less than zero, then stop attacking. Otherwise, just keep doing what you're doing. And by keep doing what you're doing, you're adding. Because it'll cap out at 120, 60 times 2. That should be okay. If they're not attacking, yeah, that stuff's fine. That's just picking random points if they're not attacking. Everything else should be okay. The one thing that's interesting is that charging, they never stop charging, as far as I can tell. So what I need to do is add in something. Probably like the relax radius is the best place to do this. Right now it's set to zero. Am attacking is false to make sure that it doesn't switch back and forth. So it doesn't switch back and forth between charging and attacking. What's the best way to do this? I probably should have arranged this logic to be more like the flying enemies. It's a little different. Probably because I did one thing first and another thing next. Yeah, because it's only going to come in here if charging's not true, so I have to do the charging stuff out here. And which means if fuzz charge is less than zero, then EM charging is equal to false. Okay, so either the boomerang disappears, or they're far enough away from the boomerang, then they'll start to calm down. Takes them a little while to calm down, though. If that's the case, we probably want to set the cap on this pretty large. Because before we had it where if you threw the boomerang and they were in range, they would just chase you forever. We don't quite want that. But we do want them to be charging you for a couple of seconds, so let's cap this off at 5 seconds. So if they're within range and your boomerang's out there, they can build up to about 5 seconds of this stuff. So let's make this a little faster. Because the boomerang doesn't last that long, it's only out there for like half a second or so. So in about half a second, you would want this thing to go up pretty quickly. Let's see how this works. So on average, it's going to be On average, it's going to be 3, 4. It's going to be about 4 per frame. If the boomerang's out there for about 15 frames, for example, it's going to be 60 by the time it ends. Let's make this even higher, maybe. Let's make this thing go up really fast. Okay. This is the one nice thing about like using fuzzy logic is you have more things that you can adjust for enemy behavior. Like how fast they heat up, what their like heat up capacity is, so how long it takes them to cool down, all of this stuff you can start adjusting. Whereas before you couldn't really do that. All right. Time's running out, but I think I've got this set. Let's try it out. I think I have it working. My first Steam refund. Buyer beware. Caveat emptor. Right, so I need to find the ground. Let's go over here and see if I can have any ground. Hopefully there are trees. Okay, we have mountains, so that should give me what I need. Okay, we've got our ground enemies out there. Their attack range or their charge range is this, so yeah, it's enough to set them off. But now they give up the charging, which is cool if they're outside of a certain range. They feel more organic now. That's very cool. Obviously, if you haven't been playing the game, the prototypes or anything, you probably don't feel much of a difference. But it feels more organic now. The red lines that appear afterwards are the relax radius. So it takes them a little while for them to give up. Quite a while. Quite a while. Yeah, sound effects. I just haven't linked up the sounds yet, but the relax radius thing doesn't seem right. They should be giving up. Am I not subtracting somewhere? What's probably happening is because charging is set to true. No, that should be okay. If attacking is false, so they are attacking. They were definitely in the attacking state because they were charging me. And I am subtracting. If fuzz attack is less than 0, Boolean. Yes, it's always a Boolean. Booleans are the root of all evil. It's very true. Except when it's false. Attacking. What else? If, yeah, they should be outside of that relax radius. Greater than the attack radius. Let me just throw in a quick debug message here to see if this is working. Clamping it at negative, so it should be okay. Speed times 2, that's fine. Probably do need to adjust some of those radiuses because before the reason the radiuses were so like large is because of that instant on-off behavior. So I can probably shrink them down a little bit more. In fact, I don't really need a relax radius so much anymore, but it's still kind of nice to have those radiuses be a little bit different. Go over here to the island again. Convenient island with the volcanoes and all that stuff. Now that PandaBits has been studying C++, if statements without brackets drive you nuts, yes, I understand. I've I've gotten more loose now that I've been in like Game Maker and doing VBA scripting and all that stuff lately, but yeah, it used to give me the heebie-jeebies, not having parentheses around everything. Get out of range. It is working. It's working, kind of. This guy is not giving up. Yeah, there's this one enemy here that's just constantly chasing me, not giving up. Sure, the chase stuff is not working. The logic on that. We are kind of getting into the 2 hour mark, so I did get further than I thought I would, which is nice. Let me just make a quick build. Yep. I'm gonna put the build up in the usual place. So for those of you who have purchased our season one game, Project Spaghetti, and have the Sapphire Key, who paid a little extra for it, I'll put the build up in case you're interested in seeing where it's at now. Takes a little while to compress all the music and stuff. So I'll just wrap up the show and I'll put it up in the background. So what we did, from passive to charge, we got that working fine. Charge to passive, that's working fine. These two are not working fine, not so much because of the logic, that's actually okay. Let's actually make this a bug. Bug? Setting? Ground enemy? Radii need adjustment. That is required. In terms of the logic, these aren't doing anything that fancy, so they are done. But until these radii get adjusted, it's going to be impossible to see it in action. So we'll save that. Not that I have a whole lot of time and overtime to do these things, but hopefully I can get this problem solved before next episode. So what we got done today? Fuzzy logic. We implemented all the fuzzy logic from going from chasing to swarming, from swarming to chasing, from passive, just wandering around to chasing the player, from chasing the player to going back to passive. Same thing with all the anchor stuff. So basically, all the flying enemy stuff, all of their states are controlled by fuzzy logic. And we did the same thing for the ground enemies when they charge you because you threw the boomerang. And also when you're just in range. So that is episode 38, Fuzzy Logic. Let's think about next week. Episode 39. By the way, I do have a pretty good idea of what my class schedule for the next year is. So I can actually start to think about how to schedule this show in the future. I did mention at least that for the month of April I would be doing it at this time, just because I knew at least for 2 weeks in a row I would have to be doing it at this time. Wasn't sure how many Sundays I would actually have to be going to school. It turns out I don't have to go to school on Sunday that often. Probably a total of, depending on which classes I pick, maybe 5 weeks or so would have like Sunday where I have to leave, kind of like I do now. But in terms of scheduling, it might be okay to put the time at like 7 or 8 a.m. like we used to do, just on Sundays instead of Saturdays. That way my brain is actually working. It's possible. But I'll think about it. For the month of April, anyway, I'll continue killing myself by waking up at 4 a.m. to prepare for the show, which starts at 5 a.m. Probably should just stay up late. It might actually be easier. So next week, let's look down here. Controller support. Are we ready to do like gamepad support yet? The reason I wasn't doing this task before was because I learned from Project Spaghetti that it's better to do additional like input methods kind of towards the end after you've sorted out the logic, because otherwise every time you make a change you have to make it in multiple places. Like, okay, if I change that the player doesn't move linearly, they move with like lerping and stuff like that, then I have to change those same numbers in multiple places, potential for bugs, stuff like that. Are we far enough along where I'm not going to be fiddling with the input anymore? In terms of the air, I'm pretty happy with the air. The ground, will I be changing anything else? Let's keep this back for now. I need a little more time to think about that one. And let's move on to something else. Level flow. What this is right now, it's basically the world is a grid structure. So when you complete a monolith, you can go off the edge, any edge you want, and go to a different room. What I'm thinking is, because it is a large world, that might not be enough guidance for players. I'm trying to think if it's better to do it more as a linear game where it's like the monolith, it's not always necessarily north or whatever, but the monolith kind of points and says, all right, the way out of the room is this way, and you have like an effect or something that you can follow to leave the room, and then you go to a new room. Whether it's worth doing that or not. Because right now, let's see. Paintbrush. Real quick. The world map looks more or less like this. You know, something like that anyway. It's bigger than this, but you know, if you find the monolith, you can go this way, or this way. And my concern is that if I do this grid structure, it's pretty easy to get lost in the world. Because, you know, if you come this way and then go up this way, then you might forget that there's a room here you haven't explored. The only problem is going back. Because you have the same problem. Like, if you move into this room, how do you know that this is the room you came from? This might require a little more thought too. Compass, edge of the screen compass. Let's try this. Because this could make the game easier to navigate, and it could help give us an answer to this question as well. What I was thinking is, because it's so easy to get turned around, obviously, it's a game where you make circles and rotate the screen and stuff. Might be nice to just have like kind of an edge of the screen compass. It doesn't, not something like super obvious, like, you know, having north or something, like just rotating around the edge of the screen, but just something more subtle where it's like you kind of know where up is and you know where right is and you know where down is, even when you're getting turned around and stuff. Let's try that next week and see how it is, because that could solve some of the other problems. Panda bits, disembodied spirits of kings living in boats that tell you stuff. That could be the Heligators. Maybe the Heligators always like appear magically like Jiminy Cricket or something and say, "Go north, young lad, go north," and they always like point their little helicopter blades up north. Be a really weird world. But we'll do the compass next week, because it needs to get done. So that is gonna wrap up our episode. Let me give you the times. It looks like the build is done, so I can put that up as soon as the episode ends. Yeah, it's right there. So I will do that, but let me jump off the desktop. Get my times. You know, for those of you on Twitch, it's obvious. The show basically starts 2 hours and 20 minutes ago every week, at least for the month of April. But for those of you on YouTube, thank you for watching our game development show. You can catch past episodes and this one over at youtube.com/BlueTenguStudio, where I put them up usually in the middle of the week. If you're watching this later on YouTube, come drop by the live show we do every week at twitch.tv/BlueTengu. This is where the fun is to be had. This is where we can talk Dark Souls and getting sick on boats in the middle of hurricanes and stuff. The show, at least for the month of April, this month, is Sundays, 5 a.m. to 7 a.m. Japan. If you're in Japan, you're probably asleep. But this time works out because if you're in the Americas, it's 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Pacific Daylight Time, 2 to 4 Mountain, 3 to 5 Central, 4 to 6 Eastern. If you're in the UK, it's Saturdays 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. If you're in Australia and New Zealand, you're probably asleep as well. Maybe in New Zealand, you're starting to wake up Saturday morning to watch your cartoons and stuff. If so, then you can drop by the show. It's probably going to be around 10 a.m. or so is a start time for you. But we do always announce what we're doing through Twitter, so follow B Tengu to keep track of when the live show starts or episodes go up, or follow us on Twitch or YouTube to get announcements that way. Of course, you can see what we're up to anytime at our site, bluetengu.com. And again, if you did pitch in a little extra for Project Spaghetti, I am going to put that build up in the usual place so you know how to get it. And if you search for Project Spaghetti in Greenlight on Steam, definitely help. It would help if you could vote for us. We'd appreciate it very much. But thank you for watching. Have a good weekend, by the way, because it's Saturday now, so you are officially in the weekend, most of you. Thank you for watching, and I will see you next week, next time. Thank you.